Hello, chess fans. Welcome to another edition of Chess Chat, a program designed to give you, the viewer, a good understanding of the fascinating world of chess. I'm George Marijanian, Program Director of the Wachusett Chess Club at Fitchburg State University. This club meets every Wednesday evening from 7 to 11 in room C-159 in the McKay Complex at the university. And with me today at the Fitchburg Access Television Production Center is our award-winning director, Darren Dame of Fitchburg. He's assisted in the control room by three-time Wachusett Chess Club champion Larry Gladding of Leominster. And behind the camera, following all the action, is longtime Wachusett Chess Club member Brian Bigelow of Fitchburg. And today, Chess Chat fans, I have the honor and privilege of welcoming back to Chess Chat for the third time 12-year-old chess master Carissa Yip and her father, Percy Yip. Welcome to you both.
Thank
you. Know, I invited you back because you had an experience about a month ago. You competed in the World Youth Chess Championship in Greece. Yeah. Now, when was that? Where was that in Greece? And when was that? Was that actually the end of October?
Yeah.
The last week in October?
Somewhere around October, and then
it went into November.
Late October, and then it ended November 6th, I think.
Okay. Now, how many rounds? You played in the girls under 12 section. You're 12 now, but at the beginning of the year, where they determined the ages for qualification, you were 11.
Yeah.
And by the way, let us show. Actually, our director Darren Dame has a photo of you from the National Magazine, the magazine of the U.S. Chess Federation, when you were awarded, you actually became the youngest female chess master in U.S. history. We have a photo of the magazine, and this was actually the August 2015 issue, but of course you accomplished that feat, I think actually in early the year, like in May?
February.
Oh, it was in February?
Yeah.
Okay. So you've been, you set U.S. chess history by becoming the youngest female master. And again, there's a beautiful article about you in the August 2015 issue of Chess Life. But you played in this World Youth Championship. How many World Youth Championships have you played in? You played in some previous ones.
Yeah, I played in three. In 2012, I think, I went to Slovenia.
Slovenia, you played in Slovenia, 2012,
yeah.
Yes.
And it didn't do so well there.
Okay, what happened? You played the following year?
Yeah, and then I played in Dubai in 2013 in the UAE.
United Arab Emirates?
Yeah.
Okay, and then you didn't play in the next, the 2014.
Yeah, no, I didn't play that.
You skipped that. Where was that held? I think that was held in South Africa.
Yeah.
Okay. And this year was held actually in a huge resort, I understand, in northern Greece. The resort was called Porto Karas in Greece. Percy, you accompanied your daughter on all these trips.
Yeah.
And what was your impression of all these World Youth Championships? Did you get some positive, I mean, as far as the organization of the tournaments, you must have seen differences in how these tournaments were organized.
I think this year the organizer, they actually did a very good job.
Yes.
Their pairing came out very early, usually around 8 or 9 p.m.
Right.
So you have enough time to prepare for the for your opponent at night time.
Right.
So, I mean, in the previous well, youth.
Yes.
They usually came out way late.
Oh.
I mean, maybe 11. The kid already. Went
you need
to
much
bed,
time to
and
prepare for an
so
opponent.
The kid doesn't really involve in the preparation, and
right.
The coach did all the preparation for the kid. But this year, actually, she did a lot of preparation by herself because the pairing came out early. Around 8 or 9, and then she will look at the game and then try to find out, exactly what she's going to play.
Right.
So I think this is a better experience. And also, through this exercise, she learned a lot. So I really consider this is just like a extensive chess training.
Okay, so
yeah,
it's very beneficial.
Yeah, very beneficial. To
now we have some photo. I think Darren actually has a photo of you with two grandmasters at the championship, who were there as coaches?
Yeah.
There's a picture here. Okay, here's Carissa. In back of Carissa is Grandmaster John Fedorowicz. And next to the taller individual is actually Grandmaster Nick DeFermian. Two very accomplished grandmasters, American grandmasters, and they were there as coaches.
As coaches to the, for the teams.
For the whole team.
Right, there are other, coaches as well.
Okay.
And Nick is, her personal coach.
Oh, Nick DeFermian.
Yes.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
So Nick prepared the opening, and then
he's a former U.S. championship.
Yes, three times.
Okay, very both strong player, but Nick DeFermian especially. And so how many rounds in this World Youth Championship this year? How many rounds did you play? I mean, how many games?
I played 11.
11. Okay. Now, you tied for first place in your division.
Yeah.
Okay. But they went to a tiebreak system, and you scored 9.5 points out of 11. Mm-hmm. You won your first six games in a row. You were leading. You lead by 1 point. And then in the seventh round, you faced the highest rated girl in your division. It was a girl from Bulgaria. What was her name?
Salimova.
Salimova, right.
Yeah.
She's a women's FIDE master. She has a title, international title. You have no title. You played a number of titled players, but when you faced her, she presented actually the biggest problems as far as, because you lost to her.
Yeah.
And then you drew, actually in round eight, you drew, it was a draw, I believe.
Yeah.
And then you ended up with three wins in a row. But you had the same point total as this this girl Salimova from Bulgaria. But they awarded her first place based on tiebreak, and you got the second place or silver. Did they award you a trophy or a medal? We
got both.
You got both a medal and a trophy.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, now there actually any other photos that Carissa we have that actually we have one actually from the magazine. We saw the magazine cover, but we have you actually. From the article that was written about you, this actually you're sitting, I think, on a couch. Here you are. Okay, this is actually a photo that's found in the issue, August issue of Chess Life. You're sitting very comfortably, a very good, very good photo of Carissa.
Yeah.
Now, we're going to present to our viewers, Carissa, a game you played in round four of the World Youth Championship, and you played a girl from Iran.
Yeah.
What was her name?
Anusha.
Anusha, first name.
Yeah, and last name was Madian.
Madian, yeah, Anusha Madian. Okay, so we're going to show our viewers what you did in this game. It should be a very instructive game, hopefully entertaining too. So you had white in this game, right?
Yeah.
So what did you open with in this game against Anusha Madian?
Play e4.
Okay. Now, are you an e4 player? I mean, or do you play other opening moves? Like e4?
I usually play e4.
Yeah, all right, exactly. Okay, now your opponent responded with e5. Okay, she's actually copying what you're doing. Okay, she had other choices, but she chose e5. Okay, so how did you continue on move two now?
Play knight f3.
Okay, our most logical move, knight f3. This is the first threat. I see the threat. You're attacking the pawn on e5.
Yeah.
So what Anusha did was also develop a piece and defend. So she played knight c6. Okay. Now here's where you have choices.
Yeah.
Can you tell me before you play what you actually played, what are some of the choices white has here on the third move? What could you have played that you didn't play?
I could have played bishop b5, which is the Roy Lopez.
This is, yes, bishop b5 is the Roy Lopez, also known as the Spanish game.
Mm-hmm.
What else is possible besides bishop b5?
I could play bishop c4 instead of bishop b5.
Okay, that's a good placement of the bishop. Okay,
yeah.
So developing the bishop either to b5 or c4 were options you had, but you chose not to do that. So let's put the bishop back on f1. What you played instead was what?
I played d4.
Okay, now, what is this? I've seen this. I've played this.
This is a Scotch game for
now. Scotch game. Okay, now, do you know why this is called the Scotch game? You know the history of why this is?
No.
You probably don't know. Well, this derives its name from a celebrated correspondence match. It was a match by mail in 1824. That's a long time ago, 191 years to be exact. That was played between Edinburgh, Scotland, and London, England. And this was played in that match. And that's and because of that match in 1824 between Edinburgh and London, this is the name that was attached to this move d4. So that's how the name Scotch Game or Scotch Opening came about. All right, so now what? Now, look, you got a double attack on the pawn, the knight, the d-pawn. So what Anusha did in response was play e takes d4. And it's more or less force. Any other move would actually give an inferior position. All right, so now, what did you do now?
I played bishop c4.
Okay.
Now, this is the Scotch Gambit.
This is the Scotch Gambit. Because, you chose not to recapture that pawn on d4 with your knight. Instead, you're interested in rapid development. You've got now two pieces out. And you're willing, to offer a gambit. What is a gambit? Maybe some of our viewers don't even know what gambit means. I mean, what a gambit is.
A gambit is when you willingly give up material, but it's usually a pawn.
Yes.
And it's usually in the opening.
To gain some compensation. You have to get some if you're playing a gambit, it's the objective of the game, have some compensation for that gambit you're willing to give up. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, here is where Anusha, it's her fourth move. Now, she could have actually tried to keep up with you in development and played knight f6, which would have actually transposed to what we call the two knights defense. But she chose to play bishop c5. She's going to defend that pawn. She would like to hold on to that pawn that you offered. So that's a logical response, right? Mm-hmm. All right, so what did you do now on your fifth move?
Played c3.
All right, so you played c3. Oh, boy, now you're offering that pawn. You're offering the c pawn. All right, so now she has to make a choice. Does she take the pawn on c3 that you're offering, or does she play something else? Before we play what she played in the game, mm-hmm. What if she had accepted this pawn on c3? Let's are on the board. D takes c3. How would you have continued? Is there any follow up here?
Yeah, I would play bishop.
Yes.
F7.
You go bishop takes f7 check. Mm-hmm. And if the king would take king takes f7, and then you would follow it up with
queen d5.
Queen check. The king has to move. Let's say the king would have moved back to f8 instead of back to e8. Then you would just simply take queen takes c5 check and. Oh, black could block either with the d-pawn. I don't know whether he wants to block with a knight. Bringing the knight is very dangerous because of the bishop g5 pin. So this is not a good position to be in for black, All right, so let's go back to the position and put the pawn here. And put this pawn here. And all right, so this is here.
Bishop on c4, king on e8.
E8, okay, so what black did not do was take the pawn on c3, instead played knight f6. All right, so this game is gonna transpose. What started out as, it's a Scotch Gambit, but what did you do now? How did you continue on your sixth move?
I played e5.
Okay, e5, you're attacking the knight. Okay, now, instead of black now moving that knight, black theory recommends that black should counterattack, and the response is d5. Mm-hmm. So that, and this has been analyzed, for a long time, the d5 is the better, gives the better prospects. Okay, so what did you do in response to d5? Your bishop is under attack.
You played bishop b5.
Okay, so you bring the b5, you're pinning the knight, and this pawn on e5 is still attacking the knight, forcing the knight to move, and the knight does move to e4. Knight e4, okay, here we go.
And now I get back my pawn on d4, c takes d4.
Okay, now you're attacking black's bishop on c5.
Mm-hmm.
Now, does black have choices? The black has to move. The black does not want to lose that bishop. Now, I'm aware of actually three moves in the theory of this opening. By the way, did you know that this game now has transposed to a variation of the Gioco Piano, the Italian game? So we've gone from the Scotch Gambit to the two knights defense to the Gioco Piano. We've had all this transpositional chess here, and we have a variation of the Gioco Piano or Italian game. So before we play what Anusha played, what could she have played? Could she have played, for example, the bishop here, check?
Yeah.
Okay, and that means that on the check you'd have to block that. You certainly would not move the king. Yeah, you would bring just that there. Okay, and you're ready to castle. I mean, she wants to take that, fine. But you're gonna attack that bishop again. Mm-hmm. I mean, and force that away. So she didn't do that. Could she put the knight back here? Could she have brought the bishop back? I believe if you were to look at the games of, you've heard of Wilhelm Steinitz and Emanuel Lasker. Mm-hmm. In 1884, I don't know where this tournament was played. I think it might have been New York. Emanuel Lasker had black against Wilhelm Steinitz, and they reached the same position, and Emanuel Lasker brought the bishop back to e7. So if you do some research, I've not found the game, but I found a reference to this position from 1884 that Wilhelm Steinitz reached the same thing, and Lasker retreated the bishop, so the bishop could operate on both sides and also control this diagonal, which is very important. But what Anusha did was play bishop b6. Okay, she retreats there, the bishop b6. What did you do now? Now, your next move I like very much, but tell our viewers why you did it.
I played h3.
And the reason? What's the reason?
Well, if I castled instead, then black could play bishop g4.
Yes. That h3 prevents actually that bishop from coming to g4, pinning, which would have been a good move for black if she could have done that. But that stops it. Very good defensive move, h3. All right, so after h3, black castle. All right.
Mm-hmm. Castle.
Castle.
I castled too.
So you castled. All right. All right. All right, so what did black do now? It's her 10th move coming up. Now, she could have, in this position, maybe brought the bishop out immediately to f5, that's a possibility.
Yes.
But she chose to attack this pawn on e5 with f6. So she played f6. All right. So, what did you do in response to her f6 move?
I played knight c3.
All right. All right. So, in response to knight c3, she decided to take that knight.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what do you think of her taking the knight? Was that correct for her to do that?
I don't think it was a very good move.
No, you didn't think. Yeah, neither did I. When I looked, when I played through this game, I said, "Is that a wise thing to do to take the knight? Maybe she just should have left it right there and not taken." Yeah, but she took. Let's play it.
Mm-hmm.
Knight takes c3. And your next move is natural.
Take back the knight.
B takes c3, okay? All right. So now she develops this bishop on c8 to f5.
Mm-hmm.
That was here.
Mm-hmm.
And what did you do? Well, I think you played a very good move.
Yeah, I played bishop a3.
Right, and look at how strong that bishop is bearing down here. Now, if she had not retreated this bishop to b6 and had retreated back here, she would have stopped any attack, you know, with the bishop on the rook. Now, the rook is under attack, and the only way to save the rook is to move it, and she moved it to rook e8 was her move, okay? So she did that.
I played.
Now, how did you continue after she played rook e8?
I played rook e1.
Right, because the rook on f1 has no future there.
Yeah.
I mean, where do rooks belong? The rooks belong on, you know, either open or semi-open files, but not actually, you know, behind there where it's doing nothing.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so what does she do after you played rook e1? Well, she comes here. Now, why would she come here? Why would she want to go here? What, does she want to eliminate the knight?
Yeah, I think she did. And she wanted to take on E5.
Yeah, oh yes. If she can eliminate that knight and then take on, yes, right, yeah. Oh yes, absolutely. She's threatening to win a pawn. If she takes here and then takes on E5, she would win a pawn.
No, that I could take on C6.
You could take on C6, right, you could take on C6, right, exactly. Right, you can't do it yet. Can't do it yet. She couldn't do it yet because of that pin.
Yeah.
So, you very wisely played what?
I played knight D2.
And what are you threatening? What's the threat now by playing, bringing the knight back to
D2? I'm threatening knight takes E4.
Yeah, and then after E takes, D takes E4, you would take back the rook and win a pawn.
Yeah.
All right, so she can't allow that. So that knight D2 is a very strong move. So she retreats. Bishop F5 is her move, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, how do you continue here?
I played queen F3.
Okay, queen f3. Ooh, and now the queen is attacking the bishop. The bishop has to either be defended or retreat. Well, probably is best to retreat like she did, and she played bishop e6, I believe. Did she play bishop e6? Yep,
yes.
Bishop e6. Okay, so she's on the e-file. Now, what did you do now?
I played queen g3.
Okay, good. Now, queen g3, she's going to play, well, now she's going to take the pawn on e5 with the f pawn, right?
Yeah.
F takes e5, all right? And you responded with, now you took here, oh what?
Yeah, I took on c6.
Bishop takes c6, and she has to take back.
Mm-hmm.
B takes c6, okay? And now you did what?
Played rook takes.
And now you take the pawn with the rook, and that rook cannot be attacked. That's a safe rook. It can't be harassed by any dock squared bishop, which is only shut it over here.
Yeah.
That's unfortunate. But see that the consequences of retreating the bishop on this diagonal instead of, you know, we see what's happened here. All right, so now, after you played rook takes c5, well, she comes and brings the queen here so she can add further defense of the bishop here, but now you're going to really put pressure on her.
Yeah, so I play rook a e1.
Okay, which doubles the rook. Is it always good to, if you can double rooks, is that a good thing to do? I mean,
yeah.
Doubling rooks is always strong. Mm-hmm. All right, so you double the rooks, and she would like to, you know, try to trade off. I'm sure her position, she brings the bishop back to f7, and like, you know, she'd like you to trade rooks, but you're not going to do that.
No.
You got something even better.
Play bishop e7.
Excellent move. Now this is where your win is, your position is overwhelming here, because now she's not going to certainly not going to take the rook with the bishop with the rook. She would lose the exchange. This is forcing the queen to move. All right. And where she moved, she played queen h6. Did she bring the queen over to h6?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that was her move. That was her 21st move. Now, how did you continue?
Played knight f3 because she was attacking my knight.
Uh-huh, right. She was attacking, that's right. Okay. So, what she did after you played knight f3 is that she played g6. What did she do? Did she make a little safe square for the queen to retreat to?
Probably.
To add further defense here? All right, now what did you do?
G6 was a bad move.
Well, the whole purpose of knight f3 was to re-maneuver that knight.
Yeah.
Right? And you played what?
I played knight h2.
Okay.
I think that g6 was a bad move.
That was actually a bad move, right? She should have actually not done that?
Mm-hmm.
Well, she's in a bad trouble. What could she do? If she had played like bishop a5 attacking here, but that doesn't do anything.
No.
Because if she played bishop a5, you would just simply still bring the back knight at h2 and have the queen protect over here. Yeah, so that doesn't accomplish anything. But this is a hard position for her to play. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But she played g6, which you say was not a good move.
Yeah, because I thought just severely weakened f6
yes.
and the dark squares around
that's
the
right,
king.
That's right. She will weaken this square by pushing the pawn to g6. But she did that.
Yeah.
She played g6, and now what did you do?
Played knight h2.
Knight h2, okay.
So now I'm going to g4 and f6.
Right, you're threatening here, attacking the queen. All right, so this is not good at all for her, knight h2. So she brings the queen, she knows that the queen would come under attack, so she moves the queen right away to g7, all right?
Mm-hmm.
Now what did you do?
Play knight g4.
Okay, now what are you threatening? Now with the knight on g4, What is your threat? I see one major threat here.
I'm threatening that f6.
F6. Me with the knight check and winning the exchange here?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So what does she do? After you played knight g4, she, I don't know, I hate to use the word panic mode, but she realized she wanted to relieve the pressure. She was willing to give up the exchange.
Yeah.
Yeah, and what is giving up the exchange? What does it mean, giving up the exchange? What is the exchange?
It means exchange is a rook for a bishop.
Right.
When you give up the exchange.
Right. A rook is actually not considered, a bishop or a knight are considered a minor piece.
Yeah.
A rook is actually a major piece, just mm-hmm. like a queen. So when you give up a major piece for a minor piece, that's all called giving up the exchange, and yeah. that's what she did. She played rook takes e7, okay, that was her move. Her 24th move, and you of course naturally responded with rook.
I thought rook takes e7 might be the best move though for black because she was already pretty bad.
Right, exactly. Okay. Alright, so now after you play rook takes e7, she's trying to seek some counterplay, you know. So what she did here was play c5, attacking the pawn on d4 twice now with the pawn and the bishop. But you, in return to that, played what?
Queen f4.
And what is your threat?
My threat is knight h6.
Yes.
Or rook takes f7.
Right. Okay. So, she thinks by stopping that knight to go there by playing g5, which she did, because she thinks you know the pawn is attacking the queen, but now you carried out your plan.
Yeah. I played knight h6.
Okay. Knight h6 check.
Yeah.
And she resigned. Now, why did she resign? Let's show our viewers why she did not take the knight that you played there.
Okay.
If she had played, and we're going to show our viewers why this will work well for you, if she takes queen takes h6, you would have continued how?
I would take on f7 with check.
Queen takes f7 check, forcing the king to h8, okay.
Ah.
And then you would have continued with?
Rook e8.
E8 check. Only move is here, rook takes e8.
And then rook takes e8.
Check, and then of course she'd have the only move she had would be block with the queen. Yeah, and then of course you would just simply take.
Rook takes
here like that, right. Or even with the queen, you could even take with the queen. Yeah, so this is why she resigned. We go back to the position. She resigned in this position after you played knight takes a7. This is here, the bishop's here. Okay. I'm sorry.
Your bishop, black
right.
bishop.
Bad bishop. Yeah, let's put a rook back for her on here. Right. Right. And this is under attack, and she's here. She resigned in this position, and of course there's
with a rook here.
Rook here. Okay. So this game was played, it was a 27 move. She resigned after 27 moves, your play.
Yes.
And this was actually one of your shortest game. Actually, maybe, was this your shortest game in the tournament?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Okay. But a tactical game. And mm-hmm. again, what do you recommend to our viewers about studying tactics? Is it good to study chess tactics? I mean,
yeah, I think it's really important because most players lose by tactics.
Yes, tactics, so. Yeah. Well, they lose, yes. You either win or lose by tactics, yeah. So I would say that.
So if you're good at it, then you'll win.
Right.
And so if you're not, then you'll lose.
Players, chess players, and we have players at all levels. Would you recommend that they actually work out, if there are books like chess puzzles, you know, tactics?
Yeah.
If they can buy books on, if they get books or they go online, actually, you do a lot of your chess, you know, research online, don't you? I mean, studying online. And there's so much material on chess mm-hmm. on the internet. It's amazing. It's overwhelming. Yeah. And it's really brought in lots of young players. You know, actually, the chess is now more popular with young players than ever before. And of course, young players love the computer. So again, we thank you, you and your father coming. We again congratulate you on doing so well at the World Youth Championship, tying for first place, getting the silver medal on tiebreak. And we wish you the best in all your future tournaments. And we hope to see you back again when you do another great achievement in some international tournament, or national tournament, or local tournament. So, Chess Chat fans, we hope you enjoyed the game that Carissa and Percy and I presented to you on this edition of Chess Chat. We'll see you next time for another interesting edition of Chess Chat. Stay tuned.